Well, hey there, and welcome to Hope Church Online. If we have not met before, my name is Jeff, and I'm on staff here at Hope Church, and I have the privilege of being your host today. If you're new here or new to Hope Church, we would love to connect with you, and the best way we know how is for you to fill out one of our connection cards. You can actually find that connection card over in the tab on your right. Fill that out with as much information as you feel comfortable with, and again, we would love to connect with you. We are actually in the fourth week of a teaching series called All or Nothing, and Pastor Tad Grandstaff, our lead pastor, has actually prepared an awesome message just in this season that we're in. But before we get into that message, we're actually going to start off with an amazing worship experience with our Hope Worship team. So why don't you join me in this service?
See the end. of your voice.
Welcome everybody at Hope Church Online. Man, we are so excited to be with you again today. It's amazing to have all of you with us. I don't know where you are, whether you're all over the country, all over the world, but we're just excited to have you with us. I want to say a big special welcome to our Hope Church family and to all of our brand new Hope Church family. We opened the doors last Sunday to our first ever Hope Church Online platform, and we literally had thousands of people who have been impacted by what God is doing through our church, and we are just so honored to be part of it. We would love to get to know you the same way we already get to know our Hope Church family. And so if you are tuning in live here on our platform today for the first time, there are some incredible tools for you to interact with so we can get to know you. And we would encourage you right now, we have some guest services teams that are available here online today to serve you. And so we would encourage you to get involved in the chat, to follow along with the notes that we made available for you. There's an online connect card. We love just to know that you've joined us today. And so wherever you are today, whatever you're going through, whatever you're experiencing, I want you to know that our teams are here to serve you today. We have a prayer team available here online that would love to pray with you. Whatever you need today, that's why we're here. We're here to serve you. Just like we would on a Sunday morning, we're going to serve you today digitally as well. And so that's the encouraging part about this season, is that technology has bridged a gap that's allowed us to be able to still come together as one big church and, again, be able to expand the church as we know it all over our globe. And I was so encouraged last week, one, by just our team, our phenomenal staff, our phenomenal team, what we were able to pull off last weekend in just a really short time period. And so literally like in a 24-hour time period, we were able to switch gears, pull off an amazing service. Even just this morning, you may not be familiar with this yet, but we have services happening all throughout the day here on our online platform. And so we have services for your pre-K kids. We have services for your elementary age kids. We have services for your students today. And so you can follow along on our schedule to get all those times. But it's just been amazing to watch our team come together and kind of regroup and kind of take the hand we've been dealt and figure out what the new normal is for us right now, react to that, and still be able to create a way for us to engage and connect and grow together as a church family. And so we're so excited for what God's doing. Again, not just through our church, but really just the big C church we've talked about. And so I was so encouraged last week to see all over the globe, so many churches were utilizing technology. And it's just amazing to think about the amount of people that were impacted just last week with the hope of Jesus through churches all over our world. And that's what I love about this season. I love watching the church come alive and be the church and make the impact that God has called for us to make. So I don't know where this message finds you today. I don't know where you are in this season. I know last week we were all kind of dealt a blow, and this week is still trying to react to what's taking place. I heard it said this week, and I think it was brilliant, that the worst thing we can do in this season is really try to make long-term plans and future plans. When you're in the middle of the crisis, the best thing you can do is just take what's happening day by day and figure that out. I think that's what many of us are doing today, is we're just kind of figuring out what today holds and trying to get through today and then figure out what's going to happen tomorrow. And that's part of what we're doing together as one family, is just journeying together step by step through this really uncharted waters and brand new season for us to walk through individually, personally, and corporately as one big church family. I do believe this today. I'm holding steadfast because I believe we serve the God of the mountaintops. And I believe we also serve the God of the valleys. And so I don't know where you are today, but my prayer for you today is that you would leave with some hope today. You would leave encouraged and built up in our time together here at Hope Church. I heard it said this week that we are kind of fighting an invisible enemy right now. And that's really what it feels like. I mean, if you are here with us kind of in central North Carolina, it kind of feels like this whole idea of the coronavirus is something we read about in the newspaper and we see in the news, but it hasn't really impacted us. And so for many of us, our emotion for a lot of it, there's some fear, but a lot of it is kind of annoyance. We're kind of like, when we're going to get back to normal, right? And so really where we stretch as a church across the Interstate 40 corridor, we kind of reach over east of us into Orange County, which affects Mebane and Eflin and Hillsboro. And then we kind of reach to our west, which goes into Guilford County and Greensboro. And we really haven't been impacted by that. And so again, it kind of feels like this distant thing that we're hearing about and we're reading about. But outside of maybe what we're seeing with the economy and what we're reading about, it just seems kind of invisible to us. And I started thinking about how this whole concept of fighting this invisible war we're fighting with this virus really is really an illustration for our life. Because I believe all of us right now, we are actually in a battle, we're in a war. In fact, we're in one every single day. And you may not realize this, but we're fighting an invisible enemy every day of our life. His name is Satan, Lucifer, the devil. And in this season, his plan of attack is to discourage us, to defeat us, to rob us of our hope, to keep us living in fear, to keep us literally dictated by the news or by even the hype and hysteria of family members that we have who are calling and giving us all the worst case scenarios. And he loves to get into our minds, into our spirits, and to keep us so beat down. But what I want you to know today, the encouragement we have is that you and I are fighting against this kind of secret or invisible enemy, but you and I have this hidden weapon that God has given us. And God has given us this Spirit of God inside of us to go on the offense. We don't have to be afraid. Why? Because we have literally the power of God coursing through our veins. And so I want to encourage you today. We have the hope of Jesus as followers of Jesus living inside of us. And now isn't the time to cower. It's the time for you and I to come alive and to live into the power and the Spirit that God has given us. Listen, I feel like us meeting together last week, I don't know about you, I feel like that was like a month ago. I mean, there are so many things that have transpired literally over the last week that I feel like that was literally forever ago. And so I started thinking about really how is the state of things in our country right now, even our own community, what has changed since we gathered together last week? Well, we're still having a national crisis, not just with coronavirus, but with toilet paper, right? And many of you right now are in a crisis because you don't have enough toilet paper, and that's a real deal. I saw that the news had a headline this week that said the police departments have put out a statement saying, please stop calling the police departments, declaring an emergency as the grocery stores were out of toilet paper, that it's not an actual emergency. And my first thought was this. then you have never ran for the border. You've never gone for Taco Bell late at night. Because when that strikes, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's an emergency. Some of y'all got to laugh a little bit today. We got to have a good time together today. What else has happened in the last week? Well, some of you are homeschool parents, but the whole world has now become homeschool parents. I don't know about you and your household. It has not gone well in my household. It has not gone smoothly. My kids believe they are on summer vacation. They believe they are on spring break. And they have literally set up their heels like we are not doing schoolwork. So literally every single day this week, we've had a come to Jesus meeting. I've had to have my dad's speech like, I need you to understand, this is the new normal. You are not here to have fun. You are here to do your schoolwork. For the next 6 hours, you have this massive packet of paper that I need you to do. Thank God that my wife, Becky, was a teacher. Before we had kids, she taught, and she loves to teach kids. But I'll be honest with you, there have been days that I thought my wife is going to walk out into traffic, right? I mean, this is going to be it for her, right? She has called me some days, and she's had some moments of weakness. I came home Tuesday night, and Becky was back in the bedroom. I went back there, and I could feel just her stress and anxiety from the kids of just long days. And many of you know what I'm talking about. And she looked at me, and she said, Tad, I'm going to need some help. Now, in that moment, I want to help my wife, but I'm thinking I got all these responsibilities. At what level can I help? But I said, Becky, absolutely. I'll help you however I can. And she said, no, I don't need your help. And I was like, okay. She said, I need a whole lot of Jesus right now. I need you to pray every day as Jesus shows up and intervenes in this moment and intervenes in our kids' lives because this has been difficult. So what I'm going to do right now for all of our homeschool parents, which is all of you who have kids all over the country today, I thought I would just pray a really special prayer over you. But then I thought, you know what? I heard a prayer last night that I think would be so much more beneficial for you that I want to share with you today. And so I want to, by video today, I want to share with you a prayer today that I think will really impact you. Check this out.
Let us pray. Father God, I am a child of God. What I am not is a homeschool teacher, God. I'm at home, but Lord, ain't no teaching going on around here. Father God, I am your humble servant. What I am not is a math teacher, God. Lord God, the spirit of Common Core has attacked our household. And right now, the only thing we have in common is frustration and no answer to the math problem, Lord God. I ask that you send down your angels of the carryover, Lord. Teacher, that if you carry the one over to the tenth place, you can get the answer, Lord God. Lord God, I am a layman in your vineyard. What I am not is the cafeteria lady, Lord. Yet again, the devil has attacked and sent down a tapeworm onto my child, Lord God. And I need you to help her to understand, Lord, that just because there's a refrigerator don't mean the door got to be open. And just because there's a stove don't mean the eye has to be on. I am not Denny's, IHOP, Shoney's, nor Waffle House, Lord God. Lord God, right now, I need her to understand that his times are tough right now, Lord God. But I see if things continue the way that they are going, Lord God, not only am I your child, but I'm going to be an inmate because I'm going to jail, Lord God. I don't look good in orange. I don't look good in a jumpsuit, Lord God. But Lord, I ask that you change the way things are going right now, Father God, and bless every teacher because they got a special place in heaven. Ain't no way that I could do it, Lord God. Ain't no way. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen, 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 amen. Again, we got to learn to laugh a little bit in this season because right now, if we allow ourselves to just be so uptight and be dictated by all the emotions, it's going to be a miserable season for us. And so we got to learn to laugh a little bit. We spent some time together last week just talking about just the emotions. And there are a lot of raw emotions that last week we were facing and even in this week. And I don't want to ignore our emotions. But today, what I really don't want to do is I don't want to just spend all of our time talking about our emotional response to this. I really want to spend some time together talking about what the church's response is supposed to be to this. I told you guys even last week, it's really interesting for us as a church because if you're just tuning in today, we've been in a series. We're actually in the fourth week of a teaching series called All or Nothing. And God obviously knew that we were going to be in this season long before we ever launched this series. We had this series literally on the calendar for months and months preparing for it. And this teaching series was specifically designed to be a series where we were going to really talk about the mission and the vision that God has given the church. the followers of Jesus, the church of God, and how the church in this season, in this culture, in this climate, is called to go on the offense. That we're not supposed to be on our heels, we're not supposed to be reactionary, we're not supposed to be defensive. We are called to advance the mission and the hope of Jesus. And then here we are faced with this unbelievable crisis that we face as a nation, and we're right smack in the middle of this teaching series, again, talking about how there's no middle ground. If we're going to be the church, if we're going to be the followers of Jesus, then it has to be an all or nothing approach. And so I want to continue today in our approach as a church to saying we haven't changed course. Yeah, there's different circumstances and situations than there were 3 weeks ago. But as a church, we are still going to partner together to advance God's church and God's mission together as one collaborative unit, which is the body of Christ, the believers of Jesus, those who have chosen to follow, grow, and live for Jesus together, who are partnered together because we have this mission. And now is an opportunity for you and I, to go on the offense and to be the church that God has called for us to be. So I was thinking this week just about a passage that really brings to home just who we are in this equation and what it's called to look for. So if you have a Bible today, I want you to go to get to John chapter 17. I want to remind you, I said this earlier, if you're on our online platform today, all the notes, all the scripture are going to be right in a tab called Notes. If you're going to watch this later this week on one of our other platforms through our app or online, then we have all of our notes there as well. And I would love for you to engage today. If you have a Bible, you can go ahead and grab one. You got a digital Bible, you can. You want to open up a new note on your phone or your tablet or whatever it is, or you just want to follow along with the notes we prepared for you, I want you just to engage with us today as we jump into this. So John chapter 17, we're going to begin at verse 15. It says this, "I'm not asking you to take them out of the world." Now understand, this moment, Jesus is praying a prayer to his Father about his disciples, about his followers. He says, "God, I'm not asking you, Father, I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one." He's saying, "I'm not asking right now that God would pluck us all out of this circumstance." But Jesus is saying, "I pray that God would keep us safe." Look what he goes on to say this. "They do not belong to this world any more than I do." They do not belong. If you are at home right now with some friends or family members, even by yourself, I want you to say, "Do not," out loud. 1, 2, 3. Do not. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Jesus says, "I need you to understand that my followers belong to me in the same way that I belong to you." We believe that Jesus came on a rescue mission from heaven. The one who created the world sent him down to invade the world. He does not belong to this world. He belongs to God. He belongs to a heavenly kingdom, but he came down here to rescue us from our sin, from our condition, from our baggage and our mess. And I want you to know this today. No matter where you are today, no matter where this message finds you, no matter what sin you've been in, no matter what you've been involved in, no matter what you think about God or church or whatever it is, God loved you so much that he wrapped himself in flesh and he came in the form of Jesus to come after you, to rescue you. And Jesus says this, "I don't belong to this world. You sent me here as your messenger. You sent me here as your mouthpiece. You sent me here as an agent of change for you." He says, "Those who have put their faith in me, they no longer belong to this world either. They belong to you." He says, "Would you make them holy by your truth? Teach them your word, which is your truth." Part of what our journey is as a church is that we would not only follow Jesus, but that we would grow with Jesus. That you and I would begin to follow God in truth. We would know his word. In this season right now, I'm going to be honest with you, many of us are going to battle in this season of this time of us social distancing. In our culture today, we're all separating and segmenting ourselves and we're all isolating ourselves. The enemy is going to creep in. He's going to get you out of your routine. He's going to get you to a place where you begin to isolate yourself from God and from just the time that you've had maybe with God prior to this season. In this season, we're going to continue to walk in truth. How do we defeat the fear and the hysteria and the lies? We defeat it with the truth of God's word. He says, "Just as you have sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world." He's talking to us. He says, "God, just as you sent me down on a rescue mission to be a mouthpiece for you, to point people to the hope that you offer," he says, "I'm sending those who have chosen to follow me back into the world." You know what that means? We don't belong to the world. We're not of the world. We've been called on a mission to go be a light to the world, to be hope to the world. You know what that means? That you and I, well, you and I, we are not tied to this world, so we are not tied to the emotion of this world. We are not caught off guard. We are not sitting here biting our fingernails, wondering what's going to happen next. Why? Because we are never hopeless. Because our hope is not tied to the things of this world. Our hope is in who God is and what God has done for us. So right now, what I really want to do in our time together that we have remaining is I really want, in this moment, in this season, I want to call on those who call themselves followers of Jesus in this season to say, this is a time for us not to disengage. This is a challenge. This is a moment for us to engage at the highest level that we could ever engage. In fact, I would say the opportunity for us to be the church has never been greater. In fact, I'll be 40 years old here in a couple months. I would say in my entire lifetime, I've never seen a greater opportunity for the church to be the light than it is right now. On Wednesday, I was in a room with a bunch of pastors, and there were some pastors there who were much older than me. In fact, there was one there who's been pastoring longer than I've been alive. And he himself said, I don't know a time in my life, at my age, is there a greater opportunity for the church to come alive that's going to have a bigger voice and a bigger audience than right now. And we're seeing that happen all over our country right now. People are tuning in today right now because they want to know the truth. We have the truth. So what I want to do today is I want to give us, again, some really big all or nothing statements when it comes to the church. When I say church, I mean the followers of Jesus. And so we kind of started here last week. I want to pick back up here from where we left off last week and then dive into some other things. And so we talked about last week, it's all or nothing. You and I are either going to live by faith or we're going to live by fear. It really is an all or nothing approach. Either I'm going to be dominated by fear or I'm going to trust God in faith. I really can't straddle the fence. I can't have one foot in a bucket of fear and one foot in a bucket of faith. I think God says, it's all in. Either you're going to trust me or you're going to live dominated by the news and hysteria and all the hype things we talked about last week. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 is a verse we keep coming back to because I believe it's a verse that you and I should put into our heart. We should memorize. We should write it down. And it says this, for God has not, turn to your neighbor right now. If you're at home, yell out, says, has not. God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity. You know what that means? When I say this verse, I cannot say it like, God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity. No, you say, God didn't give me a timid spirit. God has not given me a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, of love, and a self-discipline. Inside of me, there is all the power of heaven. God has not given me this timid spirit. Inside of me, I have this confidence and the power of God. Why? Because the one who created this world resides inside of me, and the one in me is greater than anything that's happening in this world. Do you believe that today? Do you and I really believe that God's ways and God's plans are greater? That means that you and I are not dominated by the fears of this world. Why? Because our God is faithful. He is always in control. Our God is a good God. His plans always prevail. Our God has never once abandoned us. He has never once, even in this season, walked away from us. He is a good Father who cares about us. So that means, as a result, I'm going to trust God in faith. I'm going to trust him at his word. And that means my emotions and my life and my actions are going to be in alignment. You and I are not of this world, so we are not dominated and dictated by the things of this world. I want to encourage you right now to pluck yourself out of environments and situations that are allowing you to be dominated by the fear of this world, because you and I are dominated by the power of God. We got to, again, replace those lies, replace those things we're hearing with the truth of God's word. Every single time you hear something that discourages and defeats you, you got to begin to go on the offense and replace it with the truth. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to know God's good, perfect, and pleasing will for your life. Right? I mean, that's what Scripture tells us. You and I have got to be offensive people. If not, the enemy is going to have a field day. Listen, it tells us in Scripture in 2 Corinthians 5, 7, it says, for we live by faith and not by, what's this word right here? Sight. You know what? Right now, sight is telling us a lot. But the economy, the stock market, what's happening in our world, what we're reading about, what we're seeing, sight's saying a lot. But you and I, we're not of this world. We are not determined by what we see or what we read or what we hear. We're determined by our faith in who God is. Who God is. You know what? I know right now, and I don't know if it's true for your house, but you know who's not freaked out in my house right now? My kids. My kids are not freaking out right now about what's going to happen with the stock market or the economy or what's going to happen with coronavirus. You know what? I believe in their spirit. They're like, Mom and Dad got this. And they see us freaking out. I heard someone say this week that your kids, most likely your young kids, won't even remember coronavirus. They won't even remember what happens. I mean, many of you, when you were even young or even have young kids, they don't even remember 9/11, right? They don't remember the impact of that day. But you know what they will remember? They'll remember your anxiety and your stress and your emotion and how you were in the house and how you reacted and what your home is like right now. What I want to have in this moment is a Matthew 18 kind of faith. It talks about you and I, Matthew 18, having the faith of a child. You know what the faith of a child is? My daddy's got this. He's in control. He has this. My youngest son, Keaton, we often talk about him. He's a fireball. He's one of these kids who really believes he's a superhero and could do anything. And so this week we had a lesson in riding a four-wheeler. We had some four-wheelers that are broken down. I took some parts off. I put them together to get one of our four-wheelers running for our kids. And this is his first lesson right here. I told him he could do it. Put a helmet on him. Watch this video right here of Keaton going out for the first time to ride this four-wheeler. He's got his big sister here. She's going to help him a little bit. He goes to take off. In this moment, I think he's going to run straight into my truck. Thank goodness he doesn't hit my truck. He heads out. Everything seems to be going well. He's heading towards the woods. And out of nowhere, he takes a hard left. Bam! And runs right into this kind of brick area we have set up where we put a bunch of firewood up for our fire pit. Right? And so in that moment, I'm immediately like freaking out, like, oh my gosh. So I go running up to him and I pick him up. And what you don't see in that moment is the moment that four-wheeler collides with that wall. He literally goes airborne. He flies up in the air. The four-wheeler hits the brick wall from impact. It moves back. He goes up in the air and comes head first straight into the ground. So I go running out there, and I mean, thank God he had a helmet on. He's got mud and grass all over his head, and he's crying. And I pick him up, and my first thought is, I hope Becky didn't see this, right? I'm like, man, where's Becky right now? And so I make sure he's okay. I dust him off, and about a few minutes go by, he stops crying, and I ask this question. I say, hey, Keaton, you want to get back on the four-wheeler? And he kind of looks at me a little bit uneasy, and I'm like, buddy, you got this. And so I ask this question. I said, do you want Daddy to get on the four-wheeler with you? And he was like, yeah. And so wisdom comes from doing stupid things, right? And so I thought, well, this time I'll get on the back of the four-wheeler and I'll be his brake. And so I got on the back of the four-wheeler with him and I told him I got this. He jumped on the front of that thing and in faith, he just took off. And he had this almost faith in me thinking, Daddy's not gonna let that happen to me again, right? I'm gonna trust my daddy. Here's what I'll tell you in this season. We gotta come to a place, if our Father says he's got this, then you and I are gonna trust that our Father's got this. No matter what life throws at us, our God has told us he is greater than whatever you and I are going to face in this life. You and I should not get caught off guard. We're not of this world. Scripture tells us that in this life, there are going to be troubles. There are going to be many. There are going to be diseases. There are going to be pestilence. There are going to be earthquakes and storms. That this world is going to fail us. But Jesus says, take heart. I have overcome this world. In me is a greater power than what you see in this world right now. So you and I have got to make a decision. Are we going to live based in fear? Or we're going to walk forward in faith. Let's move forward to the next all or nothing statement today when it comes to us. Are you and I going to live generously? Or are we going to live selfishly? Can I be honest with you? There is a lot of selfishness going on in our world today. We got to ask ourselves, where am I going to be? Am I going to be someone who is generous, who is thinking about others' needs and what other people have? Or am I going to become a hoarder? Am I going to go to the grocery store and there are six of something and I only need two, but I'm going to take all six because I'm living in fear? It goes back to that faith relationship. When I allow myself to get here, I'm not living in faith. I'm living as if I'm in control of all of it. And if I lose any of this, what I might lose and what could happen, right? We're not walking in faith, right? Look what it says in Philippians chapter 2. It says, don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble. Thinking of others as better than yourselves. That almost seems impossible, doesn't it, in a time of crisis? How am I going to think about other people when I have my own needs and my own kids and my own family members? But Scripture says, literally, as followers of Jesus, not to be selfish, not to put our stuff always on the front burner, to think about others. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take interest in others too. Are we people today who are finding ways to take interest in other people's needs? Are we people who are looking for opportunities? I believe this. I believe a crisis really just exposes more of who we already are. I believe that. So in a crisis situation, if we are naturally greedy people, we'll just get greedier. In a crisis situation, if we are generous people, we will find opportunities to be more and more generous. And so the question is, what type of people are we going to be in this season? We have people all around us that have needs. And as this thing shifts and evolves and changes, there's going to be greater needs. And this is going to be an opportunity for the church to decide, who are you and I going to be? You know what I love about our church family? Is we are an incredibly generous group of people. I don't care who you are. If you're a pastor or part of a ministry or even in work or business or own a company, there's a real thought right now in our world today. What does this mean for all of us? What's the new normal? What's going to happen to my company, my small business? What's going to happen to my corporation? What's going to happen for my church ministry? What does this mean? Last week, we were overwhelmed by the generosity of this church. We were blown away. That's week one. Well, as week one, we're kind of all coming out of the gates. We're kind of trusting God. But as this thing moves forward, who are we going to be as this thing goes into weeks and into months? Are we going to continue to find ways to be generous? Are we going to let fear begin to dominate us and move into a place of scarcity mentality of being more and more selfish? I think this is the time for the church, you and I, to go on display and to show extreme generosity to the world. I want to thank so many of you who are faithful in your giving, so many of you who have been part of what God is doing. Right now as a church, about 70% of all of our giving happens online. I want to encourage those of you maybe who are coming in for the very first time into what God is doing, or for many of you who are maybe regular givers within our church, but you're Sunday morning givers. Right now, this is our Sunday morning experience. So I want to invite you into the digital world to be part of what God is doing, because we have got to be a church that continues to advance the mission and the vision that God has for us. We are not going to sit afraid. We are not going to be terrified. We are going to go on the offense. And I need all of us collaboratively coming together to be the church that God has called for us to be. I want to just show you just how God, in his supernatural wisdom, knows all things. I just want to show it to you. So every year throughout the history of our church, we take part in something called our Easter gift offering. I mean, literally through the whole history of our church, every year we take a special gift offering every year that goes to the further advancement of the mission and vision of our church. In fact, last year, Easter gift offering went to the launching of our second location over in Mebane. This year, we were praying about multiplication, we were praying about expansion, we were praying about bringing online location here to our community and to our world to be able to bring Hope Church and display it all over the place. And so we were praying about that. And so I came to our staff weeks ago and I said, listen, guys, I think this is an opportunity long before the virus for us to do something even greater this year. In fact, instead of calling our Easter gift offering just the Easter gift offering, I think we should call it a greater impact offering. And it should be an opportunity for our church to be able to leverage our collaborative giving so that we as a church can literally seize opportunities locally and nationally and internationally to expand what God has given us and the influence that he's entrusted with us. We want to be a church that goes on the offense. And so we began weeks ago preparing before a crisis ever come about having an opportunity and a giving opportunity for you and I to give to something to make a greater impact as needs arose for us to be able to expand what we're doing. And so right here in this season, even beginning today, you can begin to give to our Easter gift offering, which is our greater impact offering, and even moving forward in the foreseeable future. This is going to be an opportunity for you to give so we can continue to advance, continue to expand what God has called for us to do. Again, this is not the time for the church to run away. It's the time for us to lock arms, to advance together, to move forward what God has. I want to challenge you. Even if you don't call Hope Church your home, if you're just joining in, even if you're not a regular giver, to advance what God is doing for us together. When we give weekly, that's known as our tithe. Our tithe is literally our biblical obedience to God. He's called for us to bring the first tenth of what we have to God as an act of worship. And offering is above and beyond. It's saying, I want to be more generous. I want to trust God with more faith. I want to be part of something bigger than myself. So how are we going to choose? Are we going to choose to live generous lives or selfish lives? All or nothing. Next statement is this. Am I going to live for others or live for myself? Who am I going to live for? We're going to live for us? In this season right now, we're going to shut it down. We're going to run away from people. I think about the early church, right, in Acts chapter 2. The early church was facing way more opposition than coronavirus. They were actually facing a Roman Empire and a movement that was literally trying to persecute and kill followers of Jesus. In fact, they were on the heels of Jesus being killed and crucified by the religious leaders of this day and by the Roman Empire. And they chose, as a church community, as a faith-based community, united under the vision that God had given them, that we were going to come together and we were going to care for the needs of one another. Acts chapter 2, verse 44 says this, all the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold their possessions and property, and they gave to anyone who had a need. I mean, listen to this. They're facing unbelievable opposition. Many of them couldn't find jobs. They couldn't work because they were getting, again, marginalized because of their faith. And they're choosing that we're not going to react and respond in fear. We're going to live in faith. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. And it goes on to say, and the Lord added to their number daily those that were becoming followers of Jesus. They had a choice to make. What are we going to do in this season? Are we going to care for just ourselves? Or are we going to care for others? You think there are people around us that need us right now? What has shifted in our world right now? Everybody's got a lot less on their schedules and calendars. People are working from home. People can't go out at night. You know what that means? For the first time in our lives, our neighbors are actually home. Like if you were to walk across the street at 5:30 or 6 o'clock, your neighbors are actually home. They're not involved in another activity. You know what this creates? An opportunity for you and I for the very first time to actually go and meet our neighbors. How many of us don't even know who our neighbors are? This is an opportunity for you and I to be the church, to just walk across the street, introduce yourself, and just say, hey, I'm here if you need something. I'm available if you need something. This is a chance for us to literally go on the offense and be who God has called for us to be. I live in a community. We don't have an HOA, but we have kind of a community partnership where we all communicate together. We get together a couple times a year and grill out together. We've kind of gotten to know each other, but I have a lot of elderly in our community. So we have a mass email that we can kind of send out to our neighborhood. And so even just this week, I sent out an email and said, hey, me and Becky, we're available. Here are our cell phone numbers. You need us to go pick up medication, stop by, pick up groceries. And you don't even believe the response from elderly in our community saying, it's so great to know if we need something, there's people around. How many people right now, even in our own community, need us in this season? Within our church, right? Within our church, how many people, as this thing does shift and change, just wanting to know we got people out here who are willing to help, but if I do need something or someone, I got people, right? There's just been this idea in the church world for so long that it's all about this organization of the church and it's the staff and it's this top-down leadership. We've never seen church that way. In fact, the book of Acts never saw a church that way. The church is people caring for people. And one of the best ways that we do that here at this church is through grow groups. Grow groups are our way of small groups of people who care for each other. Right now, if you're in a grow group, if you're one of the 350 to 400 adults in our church that are in a grow group, you know that in this season right now, your grow group is so vital to your life. It's a place of encouragement. It's a place for you to grow together with Jesus. It's a place where you can go for prayer or you have a need. That is still the case. So obviously, we can't meet together every day like they were now because the governor said you can't do that. So what we've done is we've leveraged technology. And our grow groups have gone online. I want to encourage you, if you're already in a grow group, to continue to meet together so that you can encourage one another and be there for each other, because that's how we're going to care for one another. But I also want to talk to the audience today of the over 500 to 600 adults that attend our church who aren't even currently part of a group, and to our brand new audience who aren't part of a group. Here's what I'll tell you. We all need people. Every one of us are going to need people. In this season, we're going to need someone to talk with, to pray with, and God has set up this life so that you and I wouldn't live in isolation and afraid and terrified, that we would connect with other people. Right now, in technology, we can do that. So I want to tell you that even just this morning, we are launching online grow groups for all of you who aren't part of a group. And so right now, if you're on an online forum, you can click on a link right there. If you want to go to our website or to our app, you'll see it'll say online grow groups. You can sign up for groups meeting all different nights of the week at all different times, and you can be part of literally a grow group online. I want to encourage you to do that. Why? Because we need to do that. We need people in this season. We need it for our personal growth and development. And our church needs this as a body, as a family, partnered together in this thing called the church. I want to encourage you right now to get involved in a group. All the excuses you had previously about being too busy and all things on the calendar, Corona has eliminated all of that. This is a chance for you to get united together, to get partnered together with some people. Through our girl groups is how we're going to care for one another. Through our girl groups is how we're going to do outreach together. Through our girl groups is how the church is going to move forward in this trying time at the church. Let me end with this. Our last all-nothing statement today is this. Either you and I are going to live to shine, or we're going to live our lives hidden away. What's the choice we're going to make today? Am I going to let my light shine this season? Am I going to be someone who's going to go on the offense, who's going to be the hope, or am I going to live hidden away? Go back to where we were last week in Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 16. It says, you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. A town or a city built on a hill cannot be hidden. You ever been out on the beach in a boat, right, at nighttime, and you go past the hillside, and you can see some homes up on the hillside that have their lights on, or you ever been driving in the mountains at nighttime, you can see way off in the distance a house. It says, you cannot hide that home. You cannot hide that light. It says, neither do people put a light on a lamp and put it under a bowl. What would be the purpose of that? You wouldn't say, well, hey, it's really dark, let me get my lamp out, and you would cover up that light with a bowl. Said, you would never do that. And so they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, he's talking to us now, let your light, my light, shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. In this season, we are supposed to let our light shine brighter than it's ever shined before, so the world may see, but it says that it will see through our good deeds, by what we do for others, by how we're willing to slow down and carve out time out of the business of our lives, how we're willing to be generous for others. So my question for you today is, in this season, what type of person do you want to be? Are you going to be someone who's going to tune in as our church family, listen to a message like this, and not engage? I'm calling for you to engage. I'm calling for you right now more than ever to begin to advance forward with us. It's an all or nothing approach. In this season, there's no middle ground. What are you going to do today? How are you going to engage? What type of follower of Jesus are you going to be? Are you going to be someone in this season who walks in fear, or are you going to walk in faith today? Are you going to be someone who's going to choose to be selfish, who'll say, let me see how the stock market's going to go, let me see what next week happens? Are you going to trust God with the open hand and live generously? Are we going to be people who are just concerned with ourselves, or are we going to care about the needs of other people? Are we going to be hidden away, or are we going to let our light shine for others? What are you and I going to do to engage our world today? Because we have a clear mission in front of us. And that's to be the hope that people need today. So let me leave you with one last question today. What can you do today to be the church? If you and I are the followers of Jesus, what can you do today to be the church? This is not some on again, off again, Sunday morning relationship that we have with God. We are called to be the church every moment of the day. We're called to be the church even in the middle of a crisis. Right now is the chance for us. And it's a beautiful opportunity for you and I to be the church that God has called for us to be. We will not sit back and be passive. We do not have the spirit of fear in us. God has given us a spirit of power and of love and a sound mind. We will be the church. We've always said we will do whatever it takes. We will do whatever it takes to reach people with the message of Jesus. We exist to do whatever it takes for people to follow Jesus, grow with Jesus, and live for Jesus. And a crisis doesn't stop that. If anything, it creates a bigger opportunity for us to do that. I saw it said this week, if we are going to be contagious with something, let the world catch from us hope and love. That is our opportunity and our mission before us right now, that you and I would let our world around us come in contact with us, and as a result, have the hope and the light and the love of Jesus that we say that we have. Now is the time, church, for us to come alive. I don't know where you are today. I don't know what you claim to be. But if you claim to be a follower of Jesus today, I'm screaming for you to engage. Let's go. Let's move forward. This is a chance, an opportunity of a lifetime for us to be the church. If you're here today and you're tuning in, I want you to know we are here for you. If you're here today and you need someone to just talk with you, pray with you, our team is available right now in this moment online to help you however we can. I want to pray for you right now. I want to pray for the needs. I want to pray for our community. I want to pray for our world. I want to pray as a church that you and I would be the hope that our world needs right now. So in this season, let's just pray together right now. God, in this moment, God, wherever we are today, I pray that you would supernaturally touch every single one of our lives. God, I believe that even though I'm here on this stage this morning presenting this message to everyone, that God, I believe your spirit is here, and I believe your spirit is in every home and is sitting in front of every TV and tablet and phone. God, your spirit is present in this moment right now. So God, I pray that in this moment, people be overwhelmed by the power of your spirit. God, any fears that people are facing in this season right now will be overcome by the power that you have given us. God, I pray that people would cling to you in this season like they never clung to you before. God, I pray that we would step up to the occasion right now, that we would go on the offense, we would be the church, God, that you have called for us to be. God, I pray right now that we would let our light shine more than ever, that the church wouldn't disengage, that this would be the opportunity we seize to be the church. We will not live selfish lives, God. We will live sacrificial lives. We will become even more generous in this season. That, God, we would care for people more than we've ever cared for people in this season. God, I pray that it would do something in us that this crisis has forced us into, that, God, even after this crisis, that we would never be the same because of it. That our lives would be so influenced and changed that we would see the world differently and we would see your mission differently. God, let your church be the church. God, I pray right now for those who are turning in today, who need you today. God, I pray right now in this moment there would be people today who would cry out to you in faith and they would trust you. They put their faith and trust in you and you alone. God, we would love to pray right now with any person who would love to know more about you, to know more about following you and having a relationship with you. God, we are so thankful for your son, Jesus, the hope of the world that's found in him and him alone. God, let us reflect that hope to the world in need today. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I just want to thank you again for joining us here on Hope Church Online, where we get to choose to let our light shine over choosing to hide it and keep it to ourselves. And that's where we get to come together and be this big C, this big collective church. And as Pastor Tad mentioned, there's opportunities to join a digital grow group. You can actually find in the notes section of today's message a link to find our open and available grow group. So I want to encourage you to go over there. Go right now. You can still hear me as you're clicking through there. Go over there and find a grow group. We would love to connect with you that way. Also, while you're over there, you can actually go ahead and export your notes for today so that you have a copy. Guys, we appreciate you being here. We can't wait to connect with you, and we will see you back next week at Hope Church Online.